Hi all and welcome. Thanks for joining. Today our webinar is Data Analytics Basics, From Data to Embedded Analytics. So first, we'll go ahead and start off with an introduction, and then we'll dive into the terms and definitions and really the meat of this webinar. We'll go then into our additional resources and where to learn more, and then finally wrap up with some question and answer. So, for those of you who don't know me, my name is Maeve Donovan. I'm a senior technical product marketing manager here at GoodData. I've been with GoodData for over coming up on 3 years now, and excited to speak with you today. So the goal of today's webinar is to really dive into a lot of the terms we use at GoodData and many in the industry use all around data analytics and data products. So we're gonna start off right with the meat of things with the semantic layer. So the semantic model streamlines data management, translating the complex data structures within your data storage into easy to understand, highly reusable abstractions that define the relationships between data sets and require no prior SQL knowledge from your users. No code self-service analytics that is guided keeps everyone within the same space of semantic definitions and gives them the flexibility and freedom to explore within the defined rules. The semantic model can easily be built from physical data model fields or pre-built views with entities mapped to one or more data sources. And then the metrics are defined on top of the semantic model. So on the right here, you'll see an example of a GoodData semantic layer with a data model there, as well as those metric compositions on top of that semantic model as we discussed there on the right. So diving into a data model then, let's start with a definition. A data model is an abstract model representing organized data elements and their relationship based on real-world objects. It reveals what companies have at their disposal and how this data is related to real-life objects. It can connect different teams within an enterprise, such as IT, business analysts, and management, to create a fully functional information system or applications. Each app or information system is assigned to a formal, well-organized data model to collect and store data and process and distribute valuable information. Again, here you'll see a simplified version of a data model brought by TIBCO with the information regarding sales, as well as the time, product, and store, each of which having those primary keys. So, what types of data models are there? There are three types of data models. There's a conceptual data model, a logical data model, and a physical data model. Within GoodData, you'll most often hear us refer to the logical data model because that's the core and what really runs our data products. But let's start from the ground up, the conceptual data model. The conceptual data model describes business concepts typically used at the start of a project when high-level information is required. It refers to the structured view of data, which supports business processes throughout the company. Its leading objective is to identify the entity classes rather than the specific characteristics of each entity. That feeds us right into that logical data model I mentioned. This really defines the data structure and how it is logically interconnected. It's similar to a conceptual data model, but more detailed. Besides entities, it defines the data structure, the attributes of entities, and the relationship among them. And then finally, at the very top of our pyramid, we'll find the physical data model. This describes the database implementation of the data model. It expands upon a logical data model with primary and foreign keys, data types, validation rules, triggers, and procedures. Typically, it's used in preparation for an implementation process. So now that we've covered data models, let's move on to our next topic. And we have API first. So what does it mean to be API first? Well, traditionally companies would first develop the product and then add APIs on top of it. In API first methodology, this mindset is reversed. APIs are built first and placed at the center of the product. API first concentrates on building reusable and easily accessible APIs that client applications can use and consume. By doing so, companies ensure that everything in the product is consumable via API. So there's always an API call behind every UI action. The visualization layer, so the front end, is fully decoupled from computations. The semantic layer and analytical engine, the back end, what would be an overkill for small projects is a necessity for large projects and large implementations. So that's why we turn to API first, because those components can be placed together to create those chained processes, which then takes us into our next slide. Talking about that, the API calls can be programmatically chained to support any customization, any integration, and any automation. So like I was saying, the API calls are essentially like building blocks of these processes, and they can be used and reused and reordered in different ways for everything from small projects to large, more complex, making the complex much more simple. With that, complex and customized projects are usually larger than just the analytics. Even if analytics is the most important part of it, there are still multiple other pieces, other systems with interfaces we need to set up and work with. APIs are the proven way to build decoupled systems into larger functional units. So how would we use APIs in this case? Well, let's talk about Headless BI and how it uses APIs. So the concept of Headless BI is data analytics architecture concept to interact and consume metrics in the modern data stack. So in traditional BI, the backend or the body is tightly coupled with the platform's UI or the head. Because other tools cannot access the metrics defined in the traditional BI methods, each separate tool your end user needs must have their own metric definitions, which they can use. In Headless BI, the backend and the presentation layer are decoupled, allowing metric definitions to be consumed by any number of different heads, either data tools, ML models, AI, applications, exports, etc. And because every head acts as the same source of metrics, Headless BI ensures that everyone in your organization, employees, customers, and partners, works with the same consistent definitions regardless of what front end they use. So, analytical backend that makes standardization metrics accessible via APIs, SDKs, and standard protocols are used. Built using that API-first approach that we just talked about, allowing all the analytical definitions and functions to be available through well-documented declarative APIs, making that single source of metrics a reality. Again, with the decoupled, you're not going to five or six different data sources and different metric sources. So it's an easier way to have consistency across all metrics and all information. So let's jump ahead into cloud native now. So what it means to be cloud native, this expands upon traditional application modeling by managing and providing services through the cloud. This is both quick and practical. Its operating resources offer a fully managed service model, which is at the core of the application sustainability. Cloud native, based on cloud computing methods, describes how the services are arranged rather than distributed. Cloud native provides various services in the form of applications that must reflect customers' actual expectations. When building a cloud native app, its structure is essential. Customers and end users should not have to worry about the app's hardware or maintain replication in their database. Instead, they can focus more on improving current processes or implementing additional ideas. So let's dive into some of the benefits of being cloud native and being cloud native first. First, there's the resiliency and stability. Several servers are reconnected in the background of cloud native applications to provide a single integrated solution. In the event of a server failure, the users will have an active connection without the network system shutting down, ceasing to function, or losing their operational capabilities. In terms of stability, the management of servers is outsourced to vendors specialized in resolving possible outages and keeping the system stable. Then we get into scalability and adaptability. Acting as a user-friendly solution while allocating IT resources, storage space, and processing power can be expanded or reduced depending on the company's requests. Then flexibility. Cloud Native's flexibility allows access for every user anytime and anywhere via smartphone, laptops, or desktop computers. And then that availability and improving velocity. Cloud Native enables the deployment of new updates, bug fixes, and outages without limiting end users. For example, If one microservice crashes, the whole application will still continue to run. And cost effectiveness. Cloud native, especially cloud computing, removes IT expenses and overhead. An organization no longer needs to update and maintain its servers, as the cloud vendor they are using will do that. And then last, but definitely not least, fast development and easy updates. Cloud native applications can be updated more efficiently because they are broken into smaller pieces or microservices and run in containers. Moving on from cloud native, let's jump into analytics as code. So what is analytics as code? Well, it's the idea that complex analytical projects need to be developed and maintained using modern DevOps processes. Analytics as code supports automation, integration, testing, and deployment, all done faster with higher quality and lower error rates. Code means plain text. This embraces best practices from software development and analytics development. Analytics as code really does this here. These were put together to allow for large, complex projects that are implemented by teams of large developers. More developers means more collisions, more errors. But how do we make it sure that we don't break or overwrite someone's work? Analytics as code. Once analytics is a code, you can use it in and with other code. So Python SDKs, JavaScript SDKs. With that code being plain text, that human and readable, it means it's human readable and machine readable. The openness and flexibility of working with plain text is critical for large projects, like I said, with those large development teams. In the same way visual ETL tools were replaced by ETL and SQL, everything needs to be searchable and editable text. So you manage code source outside of the analytics platform. Again, this makes it scalable and reusable, really reducing that overhead and making things run faster and more efficiently. Okay, diving into multi-tenancy. This is also known as multi-tenant architecture. And software architecture, and it is software architecture in which one single instance of software can serve different users. Users are also known as tenants, and each tenant who is accessing the same instance has their own defined permissions. This gives companies the ability to deliver one application to many tenants or users, allowing them to access only the relevant data through a single deployment, so that there aren't redundancies across the board of multiple different deployments. So with multi-tenancy, there is that separated workspace. Tenants can be individual users or a group of users inside or outside of the company who are somehow related to the business. Each shares access to the environment, user management, configuration, and functionality of the application. And on the right here, you'll see the variety of different end users that can be included in each of the tenants or the workspaces. So multi-tenant analytics is used by all types of companies to scale reporting and increase the use of dashboards across a broad or diverse user base. Compared to other analytics solutions, the scaling process is managed in a governed, efficient, and agile way. So again, less overhead, more efficiency, and less room for error. Okay. Diving next into open systems. What this means is ability to connect different source systems. In the same way, deployment strategies can change. What happens if a company switches from AWS to Azure in 4 years? So with that, we really talk about the open system. This is the data source switch, which does not imply any change in the LDM and above. However, the large implementation itself, the maintenance will be always larger. So how do we deal with this? We're always open to different UIs. We can easily take the analytics deployment from one environment to another, so being that back-end agnostic. And that brings us right into future-proof analytics. That means that data source agnostic analytics, allowing for back-end changes, UI changes, consumption layer changes, so going back to all of those different aspects we talked about earlier, this all done without breaking or requiring rework. This significantly decreases spend in the long term and allows for fewer engineering resources. And it really allows for changes. We all know that there are changes in who the best front end is at times, or ways that end users want to visualize it or have it connected, or there are changes in data providers and data hosting. And so having a product that's built with future-proof analytics ensures that when those changes inevitably come, there isn't that whole rebuild and regroup having to happen. So I know we went through several different topics today. There are many, many more to cover. But here I'm just going to leave you with some of the resources that we have within GoodData. At the top here, you'll see the GoodData Resources Hub, as well as several articles and blogs that are part of the conversation we've had today. There are many, many more, and I encourage you all to go there as a hub for knowledge. And if you have any specific questions, please do not hesitate to reach out to us here at GoodData. We'd be happy to walk through any of these with you. Thanks. We'll go ahead and jump into Q&A then.
If there are questions specifically that you'd like answered pertaining to GoodData, please feel free to reach out to us if you don't feel comfortable doing so here. We're always available to chat and answer questions around what we've talked about today, as well as company-specific items. And I will urge all of you, if you have more questions about these as well and want to do some self-discovery, that Resource Hub has technical articles, white papers, blog posts, detailing a lot of these topics in, you know, real world applications too. So I do see a couple questions here. We'll go and start off with for a SaaS solution, how does GoodData fit in when it wants to do streaming analytics? So for that, going back to being our open system, we do connect with a variety, have the ability to connect with a variety of different data streaming services. So it would be just building out the connectors for that to feed straight into the GoodData engine. And then again, on that connection to marketing platforms like Facebook Ads, Google Ads, Google Analytics, et cetera, again, that open system allows for us to have the, that potential connection there. All that's needed is just that connector to connect directly to those individual data sources for those. And the great thing is that all of those would be combined within the GoodData engine, the end result, allowing for a lot more rich discovery there. And then as far as the data governance question I did see, apologies, it's just popping up now. It can be addressed, yes, through our API approach. And for more detailed information on data governance, I would encourage all here to see some of the articles provided by our head of data security, and I can provide those as well to all. And Renato, I do see your question there. We do have several pre-made connections. Depending on what you're looking for specifically, we could dive into the specifics to see if the specific data source you're discussing, we already have that connection pre-built. So yeah, Renato, to your point, we do have connectors for Google Analytics and as well as GAM, Google Ad Manager. And as far as the details beyond that, we'd be more than happy to chat one-on-one about that. Just as a reminder, this recording and all the content discussed here will be shared with all those that registered. So again, if there are follow-up questions after that point, please do not hesitate to reach out. We'd be more than happy to chat. And if there are no more questions, we look forward to seeing you all on our next webinar. Thanks so much for your time and attendance today.